Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 5th May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles have been provided in the description box and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the first article. This article titled as Points of Conflict has appeared in page 14 of Chennai and Delhi editions, 16 in Bengaluru edition and page 12 of Thiruvananthapuram edition. The contents of this article will be relevant in your mains preparation in your GS paper 2 under separation of powers between various organs, dispute redressal mechanisms and institutions. The article discusses about Supreme Court's ultimatum to RBI on loan defaulters. See, on April 26, the Supreme Court directed RBI to publicly disclose the names of willful defaulters on loans and also other information gathered by Central Bank during its annual inspection of commercial banks. The RBI and the Supreme Court have been disputing over this issue for a little while now. This is the first issue discussed in this article. This article also tells that RBI is repeatedly refusing to obey the orders of the Apex Court or the Supreme Court. In January 2016, the RBI refused to comply with demands made by activists under the Right to Information Act despite orders from the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court ordered to disclose the copies of the annual inspection reports on banks such as SBI, Axis Bank and ICICI Bank. Also, the RBI refused to provide information regarding the derivative losses suffered by banks and also about the fines imposed on banks by the RBI for violating various norms. The disclosure of information about banks, however, is not the only point of conflict between the nation's two powerful institutions. The second issue is that in early April 2019, the Supreme Court quashed a RBI circular issued on February 12, 2018 that directed banks to resolve their bad loans within a period of 180 days. The direction stated that if banks failed to resolve their bad loans within the given deadline, the bad loan cases would be sent to bankruptcy courts. Supreme Court quashed this circular of RBI recently. Now let us see what would be the advantages of disclosing the names of the willful defaulters and the RBI's arguments for not disclosing the names of the defaulters. Disclosing the names of loan defaulters will bring in transparency to the system so that the general public and, you know, the investors, private and public investors, can take better decisions with their money. The disclosure to the public, disclosure of the names of defaulters to the public will help bring about better credit discipline in the country by exposing the problems that are happening within banks. It is really surprising that RBI, which has been spearheading the fight against bad loans, is unwilling to release vital information on willful defaulters to the public. The RBI's argument is that the disclosure of auditing information related to banks can lead to the exposure of sensitive information that may not be in the commercial interest of banks or even in the interest of the wider economy. The RBI also seems to believe that releasing information or disclosing information about defaulters can unfairly shame borrowers who may genuinely not be able to pay back their loans due to various financial difficulties or circumstances. Such shaming could lead to unintended consequences like affecting the genuine business activity in the economy. RBI also argues that it has the fiduciary duty to protect certain information about banks. Fiduciary means a trust-based relationship. It is hard to predict what will happen next in this dispute between the Supreme Court and Reserve Bank of India. The Supreme Court may begin contempt proceedings against the RBI if RBI chooses to disobey its latest order or the latest ultimatum, but the impact this will have on RBI's freedom is to be seen. The RBI has chosen not to obey orders that come from Supreme Court in the past as well, or which includes the previous proceedings of contempt against RBI as well. See, if the RBI is forced to abide by the Supreme Court's order, it will certainly increase publicly available information on banks.
Greater transparency will also help make the RBI more accountable. There are also concerns that the forced disclosure of information following the Supreme Court's order may also lead to various unintended consequences within the financial sector and the broader economy. And in future, the RBI may choose not to include in its annual inspection reports certain sensitive information about banks that it feels that it should not be in the public domain. Now, the displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. This article appears on page number 7 in Thiruvananthapuram edition, 9 in Delhi and Chennai, and 11 in Bengaluru edition. The article is about the new commercial entity of Department of Space named as New Space India Limited. The news article will be helpful in prelims preparation under current events of national importance and in mains written exam under awareness in the field of space in GS paper 3. The news article states that on March 6, 2019, the Department of Space has registered its second commercial entity. The first commercial entity of Department of Space is Antariksh Corporation Limited, which was set up in September 1992 to market the products and services of the Indian Space Research Organization. Thus, it is the commercial arm of ISRO. And the current business activities of Antariksh Corporation include establishing ground infrastructure for space applications, providing mission support services for satellites, providing launch services for customer satellites, carrying out marketing of data from Indian and foreign remote sensing satellites, building and marketing of satellites as well as satellite subsystems, and provisioning of communication satellite transponders to various users. The new space was approved by the cabinet in February 2019 to commercially exploit the research and development work or the R&D work carried out by ISRO. It is expected that it will be focusing on industry participation, meaning participation of all the stakeholders associated with industrial activities related to space and related programs. It was stated that it could be established by Department of Space because there are a lot of new business activities emerging, such as customer satellites, spin-off technologies, industry participation, production partners, ground stations, and satellite data sales. And coming to the issues, it is stated that it is still early to talk about the role to be played by New Space. However, the roles and responsibilities between Antariksh Corporation and New Space India Limited are yet to be divided and finalized. Right now, the Department of Space is focusing in completing the formalities such as formation of board of directors, etc. There are concerns that this new agency may take away the importance and the command of Antariksh Corporation Limited, as Antariksh Corporation is facing certain issues with Devas Multimedia Private Limited, an Indian company headquartered in Bangalore, over cancelling of a deal or contract with respect to one of the functions of Antariksh Corporation. Now, with this, let's move on to next article. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last part of the video. Now, the next article is about the India's timely response for the cyclone Phoni. This article appears on page 9 of Chennai and Delhi edition, 11 in Bengaluru and 7 in Thiruvananthapuram edition. The discussion under this article is relevant in the preliminary examination under the areas current events of national and international importance and in main syllabus under GS paper 2 in bilateral, regional and global groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interest, and in GS paper 3 in disaster and disaster management. The news article discusses about India's timely response for the cyclone Phoni, and this measure was commended or praised by the UN Agency for Disaster Reduction, which has commended the Indian Meteorological Department's almost pinpoint accuracy of early warnings of the cyclone. This warning has helped the authorities to conduct a well-targeted evacuation plan and minimize the loss of life, which involved moving more than 1 million people into storm shelters. The UN Office for Disaster Risk Reduction has told that India's zero casualty approach for managing extreme weather events is a major contribution to the implementation of the Sendai framework. In this context, let us know about Sendai framework in detail, which is of utmost importance in the prelims as well as mains perspective. The Sendai framework is short for Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction 2015 to 2030. It was adopted during the 3rd UN World Conference on Disaster Risk Reduction, which was held at Sendai in Japan in March 2015, and it was adopted as the successor instrument to the Hyogo Framework for Action 2005 to 2015, Building the Resilience of Nations and Communities to Disasters program. The Sendai Framework is a 15-year framework with a non-binding agreement. Non-binding agreement means that the signatory countries will attempt to comply with the framework on a voluntary basis and certainly not on compulsion. This recognizes that the state has the primary role. See, the Sendai Framework recognizes that the state or the country has the primary role to reduce disaster risk and that responsibility should be shared with other stakeholders, including local government, private sector and other stakeholders. India is signatory to this framework. Even though it is voluntary to comply with the agreement, India had made all efforts to contribute to the realization of the global targets by improving the entire disaster management cycle in India, by following the recommendations in the Sendai framework and by adopting globally accepted best practices. The United Nations Office for Disaster Risk Reduction is responsible for the implementation, follow-up and review of the Sendai Framework. Now, this framework aims to achieve the substantial reduction of disaster risk and losses in lives, livelihood and health, and reduction in the losses in economic, physical, social, cultural and environmental assets of persons, businesses, communities and countries over the next 15 years. This framework outlines 7 clear targets and 4 priorities for action to prevent new disaster risks and to reduce existing risks. The 7 global targets are to substantially reduce global disaster mortality by 2030 and aiming to lower the global mortality rate, that is average deaths due to disaster per 1 lakh population in the decade 2020 to 2030 as compared to the period 2005 to 2015. Secondly, to substantially reduce the number of affected people globally by 2030 and to aim to lower global, average global figure per 1 lakh population in the decade 2020-2030 compared to the period 2005-2015. To reduce direct disaster economic loss in relation to global gross domestic product by 2030. Next, to substantially reduce disaster damage to critical infrastructure and to reduce the disruption of basic services, including health and education facilities, by developing the resilience by 2030. Next target is to substantially increase the number of countries with national and local disaster risk reduction strategies by the year 2020. And then to substantially enhance this international cooperation to developing countries through adequate and sustainable support and to complement their national actions for implementation of this framework by 2030. And finally, to substantially increase the availability and access to multi-hazard early warning systems and disaster risk information and assessments to the people by 2030. Next, let us see the 4 priorities for action. See, priority 1 is understanding disaster risk. See, disaster risk management should be based on an understanding of disaster risk in all its dimensions, such as vulnerability, capacity, exposure of persons and exposure of assets, hazard characteristics and the environment. Such knowledge can be used for risk reduction, risk assessment, mitigation, preparedness and response. Now, priority 2 includes strengthening disaster risk governance to manage disaster risk. This priority focuses on disaster risk governance at the national, regional and global levels, which is very important for prevention, mitigation and preparedness, response, recovery, rehabilitation after the disaster, and it fosters or it encourages collaboration and partnership. Now, the third priority is investing in disaster risk reduction for resilience. Now, that is public and private investment in disaster risk prevention and reduction through structural and non-structural measures. Now, these are essential to enhance economic, social, health and cultural resilience of persons, communities, countries and their assets, as well as the environment. Priority 4 focuses to enhance disaster preparedness for effective response and to build back better agenda in recovery, rehabilitation and reconstruction. The growth of disaster risk means there is a need to strengthen disaster preparedness for response in anticipation of events and to ensure that capacities are in place for effective response and recovery at all levels.
With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the last session.
Now, this article is about 3D bioprinted human skin. The article has appeared on page 15 in Chennai, Delhi, Thiruvananthapuram edition and 17 of Bengaluru edition. Now, this article is relevant in prelims preparation under current events of national importance and general science and main syllabus in GS paper 3 under science and technology, the developments, applications and effects in everyday life and in achievements of Indians in science and technology and developing new technology. Researchers at IIT Delhi have successfully developed a 3D bioprinted human skin model. This development was published in the journal Bioprinting. The study was funded by ITC Limited and this bioprinted human skin model is being already used by ITC Limited for experiments. It is stated that this bioprinted human skin has certain anatomic relevance to the structural, mechanical and biochemical features which are similar to native human skin. The gene and protein expression analysis showed 60% similarity in gene expression between bioprinted and actual human skin. Now, this bioprinted skin is composed of two important layers. The inner layer is dermis, which is made of fibroblast cells, and the outer layer is epidermis, which is made of keratinocyte cells and melanocyte cells. The junction between these two layers is not flat, but is undulatory or wavy. See, the undulatory morphology, meaning the wavy structure, is important as it provides biochemical indications and mechanical support to the epidermis layer. The wavy structure provides structural stability to the skin by making the two layers attached or adhere to each other and not allow cells to cross the junction. The IIT team was successful in creating this wavy junction in the bioprinted skin model. The undulatory junction was designed using 3D CAD and 10 layers of dermis were constructed through bioprinting followed by 8 layers of epidermis. Silk bio ink was mixed with the respective cells for growing dermis and the epidermis. The bioprinted skin also retained the original dimension without any shrinkage for up to 3 weeks. Traditionally, collagen used for developing skin constructs starts shrinking within a few weeks, thus affecting the structure. So, testing on such collagen skin constructs cannot be carried out beyond 1 week. So, coming to the advantages of this bioprinted skin model, see, it will have wide applications in testing cosmetics. It can also reduce and probably even replace some cosmetic and other tests that are now being done on animals. The uses of this skin are that it can be used for testing dermatology drugs on human skin and maybe in future it will help in testing drugs for personalized medicine. In the context of this article, let us understand what is 3D printing. Now, 3D printing is also known as additive manufacturing. It is a process of making three-dimensional solid objects from a digital file. The creation of a 3D printed object is achieved using additive processes. The process starts with making a virtual design of the object that has to be created. In an additive process, an object is created by laying down successive layers of the material until the entire object is created. Each of these layers can be seen as a thinly sliced horizontal cross-section of the final object. The virtual design is made in a computer-aided design or CAD using a 3D modeling program. Now, this 3D modeling program is used for a new object or the virtual design is made in a CAD design using a 3D scanner for an existing object. Now, slicing software slices the final model into hundreds or thousands of horizontal layers. When this prepared file is uploaded in the 3D printer, the printer creates the object layer by layer. The 3D printer reads every slice or two-dimensional image and proceeds to create the object, blending each layer together with no sign of layering visible. This results into one three-dimensional object. Thus, the 3D printing is done. With this, we come to the end of this news article. The displayed question is a previously asked prelims question on 3D printing in the year 2018. It has been provided here for the benefit of the viewers. This article appears on page number 15 in Chennai, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions and page 17 of Bangalore edition of the newspaper. The article is relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance, Indian and world geography, and in mains under GS paper 1, in salient features of world's physical geography, and in important geophysical phenomena. The news article is based on the findings of a research study titled Rapid Drying of Northeast India in the Last 3 Decades, Climate Change or Natural Variability, published in the journal Journal of Geophysical Research Atmospheres. The researchers were from the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology in Pune and from Assam University. It has been observed that there is a rapid decrease in the amount of rainfall received by Northeast India during the summer monsoon in the last 30 years. Some places were receiving 3000 mm of rain during the monsoon season have seen a drop or decrease of about 25 to 30%, that is approximately 1000 mm. Therefore, the researchers set out to find an answer whether this decrease or drop is due to climate change, meaning whether there are any anthropogenic or man-made activities having an influence, or is it because of any natural reason. Note that the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology is an autonomous institute of Ministry of Earth Sciences of Government of India. The research has found that the Northeast India experienced a rapid decrease of 355 mm in monsoonal rainfall during the last 36 years from 1979 to 2014. This rapid drying of Northeast India is part of an interdecadal variability of monsoonal rainfall that persists over this region. This interdecadal variability is found to be strongly associated with Pacific decadal oscillation. It was also found that only 7% of the total rainfall is contributed by local moisture, and therefore the influence of local moisture on the rapid drying observed last 36 years is just 7%, which means that the natural reasons account for 93% for the rapid drying or fall in the summer monsoonal rainfall received by Northeast India. Now let us learn about Pacific Decadal Oscillation. See, the PDO or the Pacific Decadal Oscillation is a long-term pattern of change in sea surface temperature in the North Pacific Ocean Basin, that is off the coast of North America from Alaska to the equator. The abrupt shift in sea surface temperatures is noted approximately every 20 to 30 years. Now, this consists of warm and cool phase or cold phase which alter the upper level atmospheric winds. It has been stated that this shift is also having a profound influence in the production cycles of salmon fish and the Pacific climate. Now, when there is a shift towards above average sea temperatures, that is above average seawater temperature in the expansive area off the coast of North America from Alaska to equator, it is called as warm phase, shift towards above average seawater temperature. And when it is below average sea surface temperature, then it is cold phase. And shifting from one phase to other, it takes approximately 20 to 30 years, that is 2 decades or 3 decades. And as it happens in the Pacific Basin, and since there is a shift or an oscillation, this phenomena is called as Pacific Decadal Oscillation. Now, this Pacific decadal oscillation is different from El Nino or Southern Oscillation from two respects or two regards. See, one, El Nino persists for 6 to 18 months, whereas here it would take 20 to 30 years for a shift or an oscillation. El Nino has primary climatic impact over the tropical Pacific Ocean, whereas PDO has a primary influence over the North Pacific Oceanic Basin or off the coast of North America from Alaska to Equator. Now the displayed prelims quest will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to the final session of our news analysis. Now the first question: which of the following entities of Department of Space aims at commercialization of space related to commercialization of space related applications or functions of Department of Space? Which of the following entities of Department of Space aims at commercialization of space related applications or functions of Department of Space? Now they have given Antrix Corporation Limited, New Space India Limited. Antrix Corporation Limited was set up in September 1992. To market the products and services of ISRO, which comes under Department of Space. And similarly, we saw New Space India Limited was set up to commercially exploit the R&D opportunity, R&D work carried out by ISRO. So both the entities aims at commercialization of space related functions of Department of Space. So answer is option C, both 1 and 2. The second question is with respect to Sendai framework. Now this is a direct question. So it is related to which of the following? So answer is option B, disaster risk reduction. Now the question 3, they have given two statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. The rapid reduction in summer monsoonal rainfall in Northeast India is found to be a part of interdecadal variability of monsoonal rainfall persisting over the region. Now this statement is correct. Now the second statement, this interdecadal variability is found to be strongly associated with the El Nino or Southern Oscillation. The second statement is wrong because El Nino we can easily eliminate by logic. See, El Nino oscillation period or El Nino persists for 6 to 18 months, whereas the Pacific decadal oscillation persists for 20 to 30 years or 2 or 3 decades. Therefore, this actually the interdecadal variability that is persisting over Northeast region is found to be strongly associated with Pacific decadal oscillation. So, therefore, the second statement is wrong. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option A, 1 only. Now, the fourth question, consider the following statements with respect to Pacific decadal oscillation. And they are given two statements and they are asking which of the statements are correct. The first statement, it is a short-term pattern of change in sea surface temperature in the North Pacific Ocean Basin. Now, this statement is incorrect because it is a long-term pattern. Long-term corresponds to 20 to 30 years. That is why they call Pacific decadal oscillation. Therefore, this first statement is wrong. It should be, it is a long-term pattern of change in sea surface temperature in the North Pacific Ocean Basin. So, second statement, when there is a shift towards above average seawater, sea surface temperature in the expansive area off the coast of North America from Alaska to Equator, it is called as warm phase of Pacific decadal oscillation. Now this statement is correct. Therefore, correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. With this, we come to the end of today's news analysis. Press the like button if you like the video, share it with your friends, comment and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil services preparation.